Hello, welcome to Bend Church's online worship service for August the 28th, 2022. Here at Bend Church, we believe everyone is a beloved child of God, and no matter where you are on your faith journey, you are welcomed and affirmed here. Now, please join me in an attitude of prayer. Yesterday, God of our days, when our hunger for hope had so weakened us that we could barely speak, you fed us with the bread of life, spread with the sweet honey of your grace. Today, host to the poor, when we look for you in the powerful and the rich, among the superstar and celebrity, we will find you seated with the children, your knees squeezed painfully under the table, entertaining them with your stories. Tomorrow, Spirit of Service, when we will be scrambling for the seats of honor, you will be in the kitchen cooking dinner for the prisoners, making up the guest room for the immigrants, singing lullabies of love to the lost children of our world. Teach us, guide us, God and community, holy and one, yesterday, today, tomorrow, always. Amen.
The scripture this morning is from Luke 14, verse 1, verses 7 through 14. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host, and the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place, and then in disgrace you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers and sisters or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. And you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
It's good to be back with y'all. Hey. Oh, look, and we have hats back there. I feel like we should just bring hats back, so. The fashion is happening at Bend Church this week. So, as most of you know, and I know we have new people too, I have been gone for, a while, at least 4 weeks. I was back here last week, but not preaching. And part of that was, y'all may remember, we've been in a pandemic. I don't know if y'all remember that. Since half the people with masks on. Last year, my vacation was spent having three surgeries, fun, yeah, and then there was 1 week where we went away to spread my father's ashes. So last year, not a banner year in the life of Jen Stewart, which is fine. I was glad I could get those surgeries out of the way and spend my vacation time recuperating. I was glad that I had a congregation that would allow me to do that. Thank you very much. But this year, I was determined to use up all of my vacation, all of my time for education. We're supposed to take a week to go to education. And then we're supposed to do a week of spiritual retreat. That's what pastors are really, they really want us to do that. Because apparently we become burnt out if we don't. Weird. Not everyone is set in Bend, so, you know. So anyway, this year I was determined to do that, and actually, the week that I had put aside for my spiritual retreat, I had actually planned it. I had actually made this thing happen last year. As you may remember, we were going to open in September, and then Delta hit, and we couldn't. And we had tried to open in June, remember, because we were getting our roof fixed, and it was all going to take 2 weeks. And it took like 3 months. But whatever, right? So I was primed for my spiritual retreat this year, okay? I had put it into the ear of the people who, the powers that be who run Camp Indianola, which is so far my favorite of the Methodist camps in this area. Don't tell Settle Lake that. Because we're going to Settle Lake next week. Anyway, it's on the water. It's on the Sound, Puget Sound, and it's warm. And my, you know, my Florida, Texas self loves the warm water. And I had said to the powers that be, you know, we lead camps all the time, pastors, but we never get to go to camp just to like have fun. And last summer there was this camp for the kids where all they were doing was kayaking everywhere. And so, you know, I was like, I want a kayak camp. And I may have said it just like that. I want a kayak camp for the pastors. We need a spiritual retreat where we get to have fun and not just like sit and talk and do all the spiritual things that you're supposed to do. I wanted to get out on the water. And so they made it happen. And I was so excited. I'm going to move this now. I was so excited. And then 4 weeks ago, there was an emergency. And the people who were leading the camp had to leave. Y'all, not okay. I've been looking forward to this camp for over a year. I had friends from Texas coming to meet me at this camp. I had my girl in Wenatchee. I had my people. Like, I needed to go to this camp. And lo and behold, my friend, the Reverend Debbie Camphouse Ferry, stepped in and was like, look, we can do this. What do y'all want other than kayaking? Jen has made it very clear that we're going to be kayaking, but we've lost the cook for the camp. We look like the camp had lost all their people. We're going to have to do this ourselves. But Debbie said, I will cook. Tell us what all of your problems are with food, right? So, which may sound easy, but you know, I am, as y'all probably know now, I can only eat gluten-free food. It's not a fad. It makes me really sick. Flour dough, sorry. I know. It doesn't really work with a bunch of sermons, too, the weed. But anyway, so, you know, I got to have gluten-free food. Other people couldn't have dairy. Other people couldn't have meat. Well, Debbie, God bless her to the end of my days, came together and she made meals that were loving and wonderful. And she just did it like, oh, here, I'm just going to throw some quinoa here, and I'm going to do this here. And we ate better at this camp than I have, don't tell my husband, in years. Years. And I felt loved. And we did the dishes together. And we didn't have a big table, but we had this big area where we all got around and sat, and it was a bunch of tired pastors, and ate our meals together. And it was like the Holy Spirit descended. And I got the rest that I needed on the water, and time with friends, and meals that were magnificent. Who we eat with can fill us up. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the table, for the food that comes with love, for those who nurture us and love us through meat and vegetables and cookies. Thank you for the fellowship that we experience around our tables, and thank you for the reminder that it's so important to expand the tables that we eat around. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, we are in the Gospel of Luke right now, which is fantastic. And for Luke, table fellowship, the table is a key theme. And in fact, Diana Butler Bass had this beautiful piece earlier this year where she talked about what if the central theme of Christianity, what if our central image was of the table and not of the cross? What if, yes, suffering is a part of life. Yes, we must be willing to put our lives for others. That is absolutely a part of our understanding of the cross. But what if we expanded this idea of the table and the people we eat with, and that we made it a point to invite different people to our tables? How different would our lives be? Because for Jesus, table fellowship is political, it's social, and it's religious. And it's all throughout the Gospel of Luke and then on into Acts. So we have this passage you heard today, right? Where he's the Pharisees who, you know, we look down on them in the Christian church a lot, but they're really just the religious people who were trying to follow the rules, right? And Jesus just kept knocking on the rules and sort of pushing them over. And so, you know, we should see ourselves in the Pharisees and not see them as just this terrible class of people, because we're often the Pharisees. But for Luke, this is the central theme. So we have this idea today, the Pharisees are like, who's he going to eat with? Who's going to show up at the table? He's going to get himself into trouble. I know he is. And he starts to tell a story as he does, right? Because Jesus is a storyteller. He doesn't tell people exactly what to do. He just tells stories that just sort of skewer you, right? And whenever you think you're on the right side of something, Jesus will tell a story, and then you're like, oh, yeah, but, oh, wait. Is that me? Is he talking about me? So in Luke 5, you remember another story that he told about the table. It says, then Levi gave a great banquet for him in his house, and there was a large crowd of tax collectors and others sitting at the table with them. And the Pharisees and the scribes were complaining to his disciples, saying, what do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And Jesus answered, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners to repentance. All right, okay, right. I can eat with whoever I want. Why would I eat with the Pharisees? You guys have already told us how great you are and how you have it all together. Why would I just want to eat with just y'all? Luke 7. To what will I compare the people of this generation, Jesus asked. What are they like? They're like children sitting in the marketplace calling out to each other. We played the flute for you and you didn't dance. We sang a funeral song and you didn't cry. John the Baptist came, neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and you say he has a demon. Yet the human one, the Son of Man, as we're used to hearing that, came eating and drinking, and you say, look, a glutton and a drunk, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Are we allowed to eat with whoever we want? This is a question that keeps coming up. Luke 24, when they came to Emmaus, he acted as if he was going on ahead. But they urged him, saying, stay with us, it's nearly evening, and the day's almost over. So he went in to stay with them, and after he took his seat at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. And they said to each other, weren't our hearts on fire when he spoke to us along the road and when he explained the scriptures to us? You remember that? And then, of course, in the book of Acts, which we know is written by the same person who wrote Luke, we'll call Luke, the promise of the Holy Spirit was given at table, and it was by eating together that the Jews and the Gentiles were finally able to be the church. Remember all of the arguments they had around what's good to eat, what's not good to eat. And Jesus gave a sign, and all of the pictures, right? The idea that there's nothing wrong to eat. You can eat whatever you want. But eat at a table with other people, right? They were finally able to be the church when they realized that it was okay to eat with anyone. So we think about this. Who do you regularly eat with?
Family.
Your family, right? And your friends, we're starting to eat with our friends again, right? What do we miss out on when we're not inviting new people to our table? Because think of the conversations that you have around the table, right? They're big conversations, or sometimes they're about nothing. But sometimes they're about big, important life things, you know? What's going on in this world? How do I experience what's happening right now? And the people that we invite to the table can agree with us, especially if they're, maybe not if they're family. Some family. Maybe not some family, right? But when we invite people to our table that we don't know, that's a weird thing for us, even now, isn't it? Like, do you just have random people come to your table? Do you go to a restaurant and are like, hey, come on over. I don't have anyone to sit with, right? It doesn't happen. And yet Jesus talks about it all the time. Who are we eating with? Who are we learning from? Who are we sharing the bounty of the gifts of God? Well, partially that's what church is for, right? We had our first get-together with food back in June, right? Or the first one in many years now because of COVID. It has been literally dangerous to eat with people who are not a part of your family, who you don't know. So that's a different spin on what Jesus has asked us to do. I mean, for many of us, it's still, you got to take off your mask to eat. Have you had your shot? Are you safe? Have you been around other people? Like, it's a scary thing right now. And that is understandable, absolutely. But what we do at church is when we have communion, of course, at the Methodist Church, everyone is welcome to the table. But if that doesn't extend outside the church walls, then what does it mean? Is it helpful at all? I mean, we get this moment, this time of feeling connected when we share in the body of Christ. But if all it does is lead us to this, you know, good feeling inside of us, and it doesn't change the way that we act with people outside the doors, then nobody cares. Am I right? So there's this moment that we have when we share communion, but the other thing that the church does is extends the table to people who aren't here in this room. So as y'all know, the Backdoor Cafe started here about, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, was a way to extend the table to folks who are hungry on the street. It's become the Open Door Cafe now, and Open Door Ministries, and so now we've extended, and now we have mail 5 days a week, right? That's for 2 hours. People can have their mail, which, as you may or may not know, mail is expensive to get if you don't have a place to, if you don't have a physical address. It's very difficult to get a variety of government-issued things, but also really to get anything delivered to you. So that's one way we've extended the table, but we also, of course, started with food. We extended food. So on Wednesday mornings, I see a lot of you in here, you show up, you make food. And it used to be, pre-pandemic, that we would have this glorious group downstairs of people and dogs and sort of crazy this happening in our fellowship hall where anybody and everybody was welcome to come in and feel loved and supported, and for those on the street feel like they're an actual human being. People are making eye contact with them. We talked about a month or so ago how in our brains, the way that our brains look at certain sets of people, when we say the homeless, for many people it hits the amygdala, which is the fear center. And so for many people, when you say homeless, they don't think of individual people. They think of something that scares them, right? And so over this summer, with the ministries that we have here extending our table, we've had some problems. It's been a hard summer. It's been hot. And so in late June, we had to sort of we had to stop allowing people to hang out on the lawn because there was too much violence really happening. There was some fighting and things happening. And so we encouraged people to go down to the river, but that we weren't going to encourage people being on the lawn because it was, we were having, none of us are police officers, and as much of de-escalation as we have done as a group training, we just couldn't handle what was happening. And you know what? Our friends outside have been great about that. But what that did was it forced a bunch of people. Now we have a camp right over here in the parking lot. And boy, let me tell you, we have some mad neighbors. We have some mad neighbors. And I want to say that extending the table, once again, is religious, and it's social, and it's political. Because when you extend the table, there are sometimes unintended consequences of that, right? So because we have extended the table, some of our neighbors think that, you know, the whole reason, I don't want to mischaracterize our neighbors. I want to say that I'm hearing a lot from people that if we didn't have the ministries that we did here, then there would be no homeless issue around here. That's what, that I think is a correct characterization of what many of our neighbors believe. So we on staff and your church council have really been working with our neighbors, telling them, okay, we are listening to you, the people here, but we're gonna continue to extend the table. That's who we are, that's what Christians do. We don't have any choice about that. We're a downtown church. He wants to close our doors and not do anything to help folks in need? It's not going to happen. But what we're seeing right now in this time is that there are lots of people who would just rather not see what's going on in our city and in our country. I literally did have a neighbor tell me that he didn't want to see anything. If we could just make sure the poverty just, you know, could be shut away from his eyes so he didn't have to see it, that would be great. But that's not what we do. That's not what we're called to do. So I want you to know that we are working with our neighbors, and we're talking to them about housing first, and they are learning that the problems surrounding houselessness, homelessness, is all across our nation. Lo and behold, churches did not create poverty, but we are called to help do our best to eliminate poverty. And so what we are doing is working to, we started Central Oregon Villages so that we can get people off the streets and into housing, because we know that if you get into housing, then there's all kinds of things that can open up for you. You're safe, you don't have to worry about being hurt, which is something people on the street have to worry about on a daily, hourly basis. You can put your things away, which is very difficult. Nobody wants to see people's things over here. Nobody wants to be reminded that there's poverty, that people need help, and that people are people. People have names, and that the homeless aren't a giant, you know, congealed bunch of humanity, but they have stories and beautiful, wonderful people who are looking for help. So as we think about our ministry here and how we can continue to serve those that God has called us to serve, but also to be good neighbors to the people who live right here in downtown Bend, we want to continue to pray. We want to continue to have conversation, and we're going to continue to extend the table. Because truthfully, it's hard to extend it at home, isn't it? To invite people that we don't know to our tables. But Jesus did it all the time, and he talked about it a lot in the Gospel of Luke. And so just know that as the city, as this state and this nation continue to deal with the idea of the table and who's welcome and who's not, while I'm here at this church, everybody's going to be welcome at this table. And we're going to do our very best to love all of them, the housed and the unhoused. Even though it's really hard. Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we thank you for all that you have gifted this community with, this building and these people and the love and the care and the mission that continues to guide us. Be with us. Help us have compassion and empathy, not only for our friends on the street, but for our neighbors who live in lovely homes. Help us work together to make this city a place where everyone is welcomed, where the table is extended and no one goes hungry. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There are three ways in which you can choose to share your gifts with Bend Church. We have Venmo, and we have e-offering, which is on our website via the Giving tab, or you can send a check to our secure mailbox here at the church. And now let us give thanks for the gifts that we will receive this week. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow, we are offered opportunities to reach out to those who are in need of hope, healing, and friendship. This is why you pour out your blessings upon us, trusting that we will share from our abundance to bless others, even as we have been blessed. Receive the gifts we offer, multiply them, and use them in the work of grace and justice. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Thank you. And now, let us receive this benediction. Having listened to God's words, we are sent to serve others. Today and tomorrow, we will follow where God leads. Having joined in songs of praise and hope, we will carry these gifts into the world. Today and tomorrow, we will serve beside Jesus. Having been filled with the spirit of justice, we will go to be with all who struggle. Today and tomorrow, we will bring justice and peace to those around us.